हेलो, टुडे वी शैल सी व्हाट इज ड्राफ्टिंग फोर्स एंड हाउ डज इट अफेक्ट द रोलर स्लिप। एंड वंस वी अंडरस्टैंड दिस वी विल नो व्हाट व्हाई देर आर सर्टेन चेंजेस इन द ड्राफ्टिंग अरेंजमेंट्स ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम, हाउ द मैन्युफैक्चरर्स हैव चेंज्ड एंड यूज्ड वेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ ड्राफ्टिंग सिस्टम टू ओवरकम सम प्रॉब्लम्स ड्यू टू ड्राफ्टिंग फोर्स एंड रोलर स्लिपेज प्रॉब्लम्स। So let us begin with this relation between drafting force and roller slip. The roller slip happens in the middle zone, mostly on the second and third roller in a 4-over-4 drafting system. It used to happen on conventional draw frames, but modern draw frames with their new drafting systems, they have been able to overcome this roller slip method. So once we understand the relation between the two, we will come to know when we see the drafting arrangements in the coming lectures as to why the changes have been made and how they have been o able to overcome these problems. So drafting force, this force arises because of the following situation that is there in any drafting zone. In any drafting zone, you will find two types of fibers, or rather two groups. One of them is the slower moving fibers, which are under the influence of the input pair of rollers, and the faster moving fibers that are under the influence of the output pair of fibers. Now, what happens is the faster moving fibers will always experience a frictional resistance to their movement because their tail ends are surrounded by slow moving fibers in the zone. So they will always experience a frictional pull or a frictional resistance to their moving forward. There will always be slower moving fibers around them, which will try to move, which will try to hold them or pull them behind. So drafting force is actually a frictional resistance to slippage between these two groups of fibers. One thing we must observe is that the fibers under the front roller nip are lesser than the number of fibers at the back roller nip. And this is because we know when in the drafting zone, whenever the fibers are drafted, the fibers in the cross section become lesser and lesser as the draft goes on increasing. So the number of fibers at the top roller nip would always be lesser when compared to the fibers under the back roller. So with this background, let us move ahead. This is the graph of relation between any draft value and the drafting force that is applied on a particular fiber in that particular zone. So in the first region, what we see is, that is this region, what we see is as you keep on increasing the draft, if this graph has been divided into three regions, we'll study these three regions separately. In this region, the draft is very, very low. Draft value is very, very low. So what is the relation between draft and drafting force when the drafts are very low? That is what we are trying to study in this particular region here. So initially, as you keep on increasing the draft, the drafting force or the resistance to the fiber movement it goes on increasing. So why does this happen is because initially, as you keep on increasing the draft value, the fibers, whatever crimp they have or entanglement they have, they try to lose that crimp and they try to straighten out. And as they are straightening out during this phase, the sliver, the bulk, it reduces and it somewhat contracts. And with that small amount of lateral contraction, what happens is the fibers tend to come closer and they become more compact, and it will start holding on to the faster moving fibers and not allow them to go, and this increases the resistance in this region. So in the initial region, as you keep on increasing the draft, you'll find that the drafting force will increase. Now what happens in region 2? In region 2, again, still, if you go on increasing the draft in a particular drafting zone, you find that the drafting force that is there, that is the resistance to movement, doesn't follow a particular pattern, what happens is it will be up and down. The drafting force is fluctuating in the small region, as you can see. It is increasing, but still it is fluctuating within this range. So that's why you see this wave kind of pattern here. In this region, it is the critical draft. It is known as a critical draft value. And the drafting force acts in a, it's called as a stick slip manner. It's a very, very unstable zone. So we should always see to it that the draft that we apply in any drafting zone of our draw frame should not fall in this critical draft value, because it creates a lot of uneven output of the slider. So what happens in this region is that in this region, as we are again in this region also, we are increasing the draft. As the draft goes on increasing, the draft values will encourage the fiber slippage. That means it will allow sliding of the fibers, and the fibers tend to straighten out. But as soon as this happens, the sliver contraction, lateral contraction takes place, and again the fibers are not allowed to move ahead. They are resisted, and then the drafting force increases, and so this keeps on happening in a cyclic manner. As the draft goes on increasing, as soon as you still increase the draft, again it encourages fiber slippage. But then again, it leads to more sliver lateral contraction, and then your drafting force increases. So drafting force increase and decrease happens with the increase in draft, and this particular region where the draft values are very, very critical, this region should be avoided. So coming to then the third zone, we can see that as we go on increasing the draft, still further the drafting force reduces. And it comes down to a very low value. So the explanation to this is, as the draft values are high, keeps on going on increasing, so the number of fibers below the front roller nip would be very, very few as compared to those under the back roller nip. So that is why the area of contact, since there are very few fibers, so the area of contact between those few fibers and the slow moving fibers which are trying to pull them is very, very low, and that's why they provide hardly any resistance to their movement, and hence the drafting force decreases. So basically the fibers are able to slip against each other and drafting takes place. So that's why we can observe that as the drafting increases, the drafting force goes on reducing in this region. So this is the explanation of the relation between draft and drafting force. As you go on increasing the draft, this is the kind of drafting force curve that you get. So we should always see to it that our drafting values lie somewhere in this region rather than this unstable region. So this tells us how much draft we should be applying in any particular zone. Studying this drafting force values will also tell us the relation. As we go further in this lecture, we'll come to know the relation between this drafting force and the amount of roller slip that might take place. And in the next lecture, we can study what are the remedies. So let us see factors affecting drafting force. So there are many other factors which affect them, so let us see them one by one. So if the fiber that we are processing, it depends on the length of that particular fiber. So if the length is length, you keep on increasing fiber length being processed, if it increases, then the drafting force will increase. That means it is quite directly proportional. Then it also depends on the draft values. So as we just saw, if we increase the draft values, the drafting force will go on reducing, especially in region 3. If it also depends on the roller setting, if you increase the roller setting, the drafting force would reduce. But if you keep on increasing the roller setting to a very high value, as compared to the effective length that we are going to process, then again because of poor guidance, it might lead to a lot of unevenness. So we must see that in the roller setting should be optimum. Although increasing the roller setting would reduce drafting force, but that does not mean we can keep on increasing the roller setting. Also, the drafting force depends on the number of fibers in the cross section of the sliver, which is almost directly proportional. So more the number of fibers in the cross section, more is the drafting force, because they will try to restrict the movement of the fast moving fibers, and that resistance is actually drafting force. Also, longer and coarser fibers will require more drafting force for their withdrawal. So in this, longer fibers we have already discussed, as the fiber length increases, drafting force will increase. But at the same time, if the fibers are coarser, then you will require more drafting force for their withdrawal. There are some other factors also which affect the resistance to movement of the fibers, and there are three major categories in which you can classify them. First one is the fiber characteristic. So the frictional coefficient between the fibers, because there are various different types of fibers that we may process, so if the static frictional coefficient between the fibers is important, so if it is high, then in that case your drafting force, that means the resistance to movement of fibers, will be very high. Obviously, even if the fiber surface is very rough, you'll find that the drafting force will increase. At the same time, crimps lead to sort of texture, and it leads to some kind of resistance to movement if it is there in the fiber. So as the number of crimps in the fiber is increased, the drafting force will also increase, and this happens because of mechanical interlocking between the fibers that are crimped. Then there are some factors which depend on the sliver structure. If the sliver, the degree of entanglement is very high, for example, if you are using a car sliver in which the degree of entanglement is high, in that case the drafting force will also be high. That means there will be a lot of resistance to the slippage of fibers. And also, if the sliver that you are feeding is very, very compact, then in that case also the drafting force will obviously increase, since it will also increase the degree of contact between the fibers. The more compact the fibers, more is the contact between adjacent fibers. Next, we come to the process parameters. Amongst the process parameters, we have seen this already, is a draft zone setting. If you increase the draft zone setting in relation to the fiber length, then drafting force will reduce. Also, if you increase the drafting speed, that we have seen already in the graph earlier, if you increase the drafting speed, then also the drafting force will be affected, and it affects the dynamic coefficient of, since it affects the dynamic coefficient of friction. So let us see some little bit theory on how the slippage of the top middle rollers take place. Slippage is normally seen in the middle zone of a 4/4 conventional drafting arrangement, which is shown here. And this pair of rollers is any one of these rollers, middle rollers. One of them is shown here just as a representation. So let us see what are the forces that are acting in this area, and to avoid slippage, what we need to do. If there is a roller slippage, in that case it means that the drafting is not happening as it should happen, because the roller will start moving at a slower speed, because it loses contact with the bottom roller, and the bottom roller is not able to transfer the speed to the top roller, and that is why the slippage happens. So what are the forces acting in this area? The T1 and T2, if they are the drafting forces, and the one acting in the forward direction and one acting in the backward direction. Now these are the forces that are due to the fiber movement, and T1 and T2 are the, say they are the values. And F1 is the frictional force on the bottom roller that is acting And if F2 is the reaction of the frictional force on the top roller, then the forces would look like this. And what you see is slippage will happen if T2 plus F2, that is if it is more than T1 and F1, that is if this total force is more as compared to the forces that is dragging it behind, then in that case the top roller will slip. So the remedy is to increase the gripping force. Slippage basically happens because there is not enough gripping force between the top and the bottom rollers, and speeds are not being transferred as efficiently, and that is why we need to see that the gripping for no slip condition, the grip that is shown here as P should always be more than the sum of the drafting forces that are applicable in the forward and the backward direction. So the sliver is pulled back by the rollers behind, causes the top roller to slip. The fibers that are there behind in this middle zone would try to pull the fibers backward and resist them from going moving forward at the output roller speed, and that's why the top roller tends to slip. So the remedy for this would be to increase F1, and that is why to have more flutes on the bottom roller so that you increase the grip, and also increase top roller pressure so that there is enough grip which will help the top roller to remain in touch with the bottom roller. Also, what you can do is reduce draft in the middle zone and make it close to 1. So it sort of isolates this middle zone from the back and the front zone, so that the drafting forces acting in this region will not affect, or rather resist, the fiber movement. So reduce the draft in the middle zone, or you can have a common top roller on two bottom rollers, which we will see when we see drafting roller arrangement, how it is done. And the draft between second and third roller, that is middle zone, will be almost equal to 1. We can also increase setting in the middle zone. So to avoid backward slippage, these are the remedies that we see how we can fix them. At the same time, if the front draft, the zone in the front zone, is high, too high, then in that case also the top roller will lose contact with the bottom roller. The sliver is pulled out from the back roller nip by the drafting force in the front drafting zone, which is very, very high, which causes the middle top roller to run slower than the bottom roller. That means basically the top roller slips. And we see the condition for no slip. That means again what we see is F2 plus F1, that is a grip, should be very much more than the drafting force. It is a condition which is similar to the previous one. So again, the remedies are the same. So we have to have flutes on the bottom rollers, which we have seen the axial and the spiral and the knurled type of bottom rollers, and the different types of flutes. So the flutes help in better grip on the fibers, and these fibers will be able to transfer the speed from the bottom roller to the top roller. As we know that the top roller doesn't have any positive drive, so the flutes as well as the increase in the top roller pressure will help it to remain in touch with the bottom roller in spite of the sliver being in between them, and reduce the slippage. Also, the same earlier remedy, you can increase the draft in the back zone and reduce in the middle zone. Have one common top roller or on two bottom rollers, and make the draft between second and third roller equal to 1. So the remedies in both the cases, whether whatever kind of slip is there. So in conclusion, we can say that to avoid any kind of roller top roller slippage and erratic drafting taking place, these are the remedies. The bottom rollers must have flutes. You must have some kind of pressure on a top roller, and if possible isolate the back and the front drafting zones by reducing the draft in the middle zone or keeping the draft equal to 1, which separates the two drafting regions. So that's it for today. Thank you.